Okay, hello and welcome back. My name is Cameron Kirk and this is my series of videos on programming in Verilog. And in this series, we are working with the DE10 Nano FPGA system on chip, the Cyclone 5. In today's video, we are going to be making an accumulator, a 8-bit accumulator. In the previous video, right before this one, we did a full adder, an 8-bit full adder, but one of the caveats was the implementation did not use any registers. So there was no memory for our computer to remember what numbers it has and save the result into memory. We didn't have any of that. So in this video, we're going to make an accumulator, which means we need to remember what number we were at, so that we can add a number to it or add one to it and get to the next number and then save it and keep track of this number in a register. So all an accumulator does is it just accumulates or counts up. You can call it a counter if you want to call it that. And yeah, so without further ado, let's jump right into it. So I'm going to create a new project. And we're going to go through this. We are going to put this design on the DE10 Nano. So let me make a new folder. Before I started recording, I just wanted to make sure that my design was actually going to work. So I made that vid10 test. Now we're just going to do vid10. And this is going to be where our design will go. I'm going to call this byte accumulator. I'm just going to put accum, accum. Empty project, next. Go to devices, we're doing the SE base. I'm going to stretch this guy out. We'll go to the bottom, move this over. We want this one, the BA6U23I7. We'll click next, next, and finish. All right. We are ready to start programming. Still making the project. Yeah, so registers. You can literally think of a register as computer memory. And a register represents data storage. And we can synthesize one on the FPGA. So this is not emulating a register. This is in hardware actual active memory. So I clicked file new and I'm going to add a new Verilog HDL file and I'm just going to type something here temporarily and save it. Save. And I'm going to hop into Visual Studio Code just so I can make that font size a little bit bigger for the recording. So give me just one moment to open up my text editor. Okay, so here we are, and there is the ASDF that I typed. Let me make this font size a little bit bigger. By the way, if you just want to jump into the code, I am going to post a link to a GitHub that is holding all of the codes up till now and every video I'm going to be doing next. There's going to be a link in the description to a GitHub repository that I'm not sure how I'm going to organize it yet, but it's going to have all of the Verilog codes in there if you just want quick access to you know, the code and you want to skip the explanation and the live coding. But for those of you that are here for the live coding, let's start coding. So we're going to define a module, and this will be we have to name it our top level entity that we defined the project to be. So that's going to be the same name as the project name for me. There is a way to change it, but it is a pain in the neck to change. So then we're going to do nmodule. Great. Okay, so the port list here, we have a button and we have an LED. If I switch over to the tabletop view, let me take off the power for a second. Ooh, that got a little warm. Okay. Oh, this is very strange. I have the autofocus disabled, so You should be able to see better. I want it over here. Okay, so the LEDs are on this side of the board, and we have 8 LEDs all across here. And that exactly lines up with our byte accumulator. So the plan is we're going to program key 0 to be a plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, and then we're going to have the LEDs represent the contents of our register. So 8 LEDs, 1 button. That is why we came over to this view. So let's come back over, and we're going to have an input for a button, and we are going to have output for 7 LEDs. Output, 8 LEDs, starting from LED number 7 down to LED number 0. There we go. And then now we're going to make our register. So this will be a register of bit 7 down to bit 0 and everything in between. And we'll call this counter. You can name it whatever you like. Just remain consistent with the name you pick. And so registers, they cannot be, they're going to hold their storage value. So whatever bit is stored in a register, it's going to stay there until there is an initial or always block. So you can't assign a bit in a register. You need to use a different keyword. So we can't assign like this. That's for assigning nets. We're working with a totally different data type here in Verilog, and they want a keyword for always or initial. And the reason for this is when you're working with memory, you're typically working in a sequential circuit and not a combinational circuit. Combinational means all of the values are assigned in parallel and instantly. If one thing changes on one line, the whole thing updates instantly. With sequential circuits, you're working with states, so you're transitioning states every single clock tick. You're going to the next state type of thing. And so with sequential circuits, you don't have that, parallel concurrency sort of computation. You have sequential computation. Anyways, so we want an always block, and then we're going to say at the positive edge of the button. So when you get signals, it usually comes in as a square wave. And you can have the positive edge or the negative edge. So what do you want to be the trigger for what's about to happen? And we're saying the positive edge or the rising state of a button signal with this line of code here. Then we're going to do count. And we're going to let count be equal to whatever count was, plus a 1-bit value of binary 1, which is basically plus 1. And we're done. So we're taking whatever's in count, we're adding 1 to it, and we're putting it back into count, the register. So now what we need to do is link up this register to our LEDs, so we can literally use the LEDs to display the byte in this register. And the way we're going to do that is through assign. So we can't assign the register, but we can assign other nets to values contained in a register. So in this case, we're going to say LED number 7 is going to be equal to count number 7. So this is the 7th bit in the register. It's going to drive the 7th LED. And I'm going to go through and do it this way. So I'll paste all these guys, and then I think I can... Am I doing this right? Oh no. Let me pause the recording. Okay, we're back. I wanted to add multiple cursors. So it's Control Shift Alt down arrow down arrow. Oh, this isn't really what I want to do, is it? Delete. Yeah, this isn't even okay. I just have to go through and do it one by one. Oh wait, Control Shift Alt click. Control Shift Control Alt. All right, hold on. Let me pause it. Okay, I'm back. It's Alt click. That's what I'm looking for. So Alt click. All right. So delete. Oh, Control Z. Let me bring back that column. There we go. All right. So Alt click 6. Nice. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. That was fancy. I've never actually needed to use that feature before. So here is our completed code. And just as a brief aside, I don't really think it's super necessary to do this unless if you're starting to work with 32-bit registers, maybe 16-bit registers. You don't want to have to go through this process of assigning a vector like that. So I found on Stack Overflow, you can do a, so here's someone doing something similar. This guy has the answer. So I encourage you to try this out in your code if you want to be adventurous. Let me increase that size. Ah, that's fine. They're doing a for loop and they're iterating through each item in the vector to do the assignment. And they're saying it's the equivalent of going through them all and typing that number in. So anyways, definitely worth mentioning, but I'm not going to do it here. I'm just going to keep moving along. So our code is done. Let's go ahead and get this on the DE10 Nano and we'll finish out this video. So I'm going to close Visual Studio. I'll keep Visual Studio Code open. We're going to go back to Quartus. We're going to reload that file. There's all of our code. Excellent. Let's go ahead and do our assignments. Or do we have to do analysis and synthesis first? Let's see if it gets us into the pin planner. Okay, we have to do analysis and synthesis first. So I'm going to close the pin planner, select analysis and synthesis, right click, start. And that will do just that step. And while this is going, I'm going to pause the recording. Okay, we are back and that step is finished. And so now let's try to do our pin planner. So assignments and then pin planner. And here we go. And now our ports are all loaded in. We have the button and we have the LEDs. So I already have the schematic PDF open. Let me bring this up into view. And this is the schematic for the DE10 Nano. And we can see here key number 1 and key number 0. I'm going to use key 0. Let me switch over to the tabletop. Key 0 is, where is my, key 0 is this one over here. So we're going to use that one. Okay, so key 0 is on AH17. So that's the pin code. So let me make sure you can see this. So on location, I'm going to type in AH17 and push enter. And it fixed the capitalization for me. Now we have to do the LEDs. And if I switch back to the schematic, whoa, too far. Page number 3, right across from key 0 are some of our LEDs, not the full list. The other two are hiding over on the left side. So when we get to them, we'll do those. Number 7 is AA23. Number 7, AA23. Number 6 is Y16. Number 5 is on the other side. We'll slide over here. AE26. AE26. Number 4, AF26. AF26. Good. Number 3, slide back over here. Number 3. V15. Number 2. V16, number 1, AA24, and number 0, W15. Great. Our pin assignments are done. So we can close out of the pin planner, we can minimize the schematic, and now we're back in Cortis. And we're ready to compile, so I'm going to click this compile button. Actually, I'll right-click on compile design, and I'll click start. And it's going to go through all of these. I'm going to pause the recording while this loads, and we'll come back when it's done. Okay, we are back, and that is finished. So at this time, if you would like for good practice, you can go ahead and do a vector waveform for our design before programming your board. I don't really think it's necessary though, so I'm going to skip that step for this project. So let's go ahead and program the board. I'm going to switch over to the tabletop view and connect power to the board. There you go. And connect to the USB blaster. Great. And so now we're connected. Let's come back over to the desktop. And let's get our tools programmer. There it is. And then now that we're in here, we want to make sure hardware setup is selected to the DESOC or system on chip. We're going to do, auto detect. And we have the 5CE, we'll just leave this default, click OK. There it goes, and then say yes, and then double click on where it says file, where it says none, double click on that. Go to output files, select your SOF file, click open. Check the box for program configure, and then click the start button. And it says success. 100% successful. So we're done. Let's switch over to the tabletop. Our design should be on the board now. So when I come over here and I press key 0, we have one LED turned on. Let me adjust the exposure so you can really see. You can really see our LEDs. Give me a second here. Lower that exposure. Okay, let's go up one. That's probably good. Okay, so we counted to one. Let's do some more counting. Now we're at binary two, so that second LED is on. There's three, so one and two are on. And four, so five, six. As you can see, we're counting in binary. And we can count all the way up. So that is the end of our video. We have successfully implemented the power of registers and the power of computer memory in our FPGA. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Cameron Kirk, and I will see you in the next one. Take care. Bye.